Thank you. Well, welcome everyone. My name is Emily. Also go by Tech Emily, Pitbull, depends on who you ask. We're going to go over RFID badge technology today that's currently existing in the wild and how to exploit those systems. And of course, you gotta get in. Let me in. So again, my name is Emily. I am an information security analyst on the blue team side. I'm also a physical penetration tester, and I'm a DEF CON goon for speaker operations, so I'm sure whenever you've been hungover at 9 in the morning and someone's yelled at you through the speaker, that might have been me. I'm also a 2X dog mom, so these are my babies that keep my heart full. So I have a few goals that I want to accomplish in this talk. First off, we're going to give a comprehensive overview of physical access control systems and its underlying components. We're going to go over RFID badging, the basics of RFID badge technology, and from presentation of credential until the door becomes unlocked when you can access the facility. We're going to go over common exploits, the weaknesses in the systems, and how to attack them, and tools, because wouldn't you want to get something to use all of this information you're about to learn, so you can go do some of this stuff. But again, systems that you either own or have explicit written permission to test. Don't tell them I told you how to do it. So, physical access control systems. Yay, more acronyms. When one thinks of badge technology and physical access control, usually what one thinks is this. You have a physical card or fob of some sort, a door with a reader, and an electronic lock that will let you in once you present a valid credential to the reader. So how does the door open? So first off, a credential is presented to the reader. Then the reader interprets the data and sends it to the door controller. The controller validates the credential and sends a signal back to the electronic locking mechanism, which is laser pointer right here, and it's usually physically connected, that's why I put these two wires right there, to the door controller. The door controller is an embedded device, usually runs on Linux, takes multiple inputs, makes functional outputs based off those inputs. And since they're ran on Linux, and usually it's installed by a third-party access control vendor, you can imagine probably not patched, probably on the corporate network, probably in a place it shouldn't be, because a lot of these deployment companies, they'll tell the client, oh, it's not a computer, it's just a controller. Obviously, it's a computer, so take that into account. So basic components of access control systems. So again, the control panel is expecting an input of some kind, and the input can be a credential, like a card, the little prox card, the little RFID fobs. Then the input, like the card talks to the reader, and then the reader sends that input over to the controller. That's why it's on this side of the diagram. And then it will send that signal over to then open these locking mechanisms. And I'm sure you've seen these locking mechanisms in a lot of corporate buildings. You have the mag lock system, you have the all-in-one, you have the one where you hear it unlock right as soon as you walk into the sensor. So we're going to take a step all the way back in history. Because for me to give you a full understanding of access control, you need to understand WGAN. And in the access control world, WGAN can refer to a physical credential, a signaling protocol, a bit format, or a nice gentleman who likes to play the piano and tinker in his spare time, John Richard WGAN. This nice gentleman, inventor of the signaling technology, the WGAN effect. And he was born in Germany in the 30s, immigrated to the U.S. Born in Germany in 1912, immigrated to the U.S. in the 30s. He's a musician by training. He was a classically trained musician and studied at Juilliard. So that means he was working in STEM without a STEM degree. Crazy. Absolutely crazy, I'm sure. He became interested in audio amplifiers, started designing tape recorders in the 40s, and then discovered the WGAN effect and patented his discovery in 1974. And the WGAN effect is a physical phenomenon in which a special wire, named after this gentleman, John WGAN, gives off electromagnetic fields. And fun fact, John discovered the Wiegand effect before he even had access to an oscilloscope. If you've ever seen an oscilloscope, it's used in electronic debugging for actual circuits and cards. It's really, really down into the computer engineering level. So that's very crazy that he was able to make this discovery without any assistive technology. And that's where his time at Juilliard comes in. Wiegand had perfect pitch, which enabled him through a series of magnets to listen to the magnetic pulses given off by his own wire. So because of his perfect pitch and the years of training it took for him to train his own ear, he was able to listen to magnetic pulses and make this discovery. So the characteristics of his wire made them ideal for numerous industrial applications, from utility meters, speed sensors, anti-lock brakes, casino chips, and of course, physical access control systems. This is the wire. I'm not going to go super in-depth into it, but basically it had a special design where there was an outer core and an inner core. The outer core is hard. The inner core is soft. When the outer core becomes fully magnetized, then it can start sending magnetization to the inner core, and that will then cause the polarity to flip, and you can harness that energy for all types of sensing and motion applications. So that's revolutionary at the time, because the only current credentialing technology that was being used before Wiegand was magstripe. And I'm sure you've put your phone next to a magstripe card, and then it got wiped. That was a very big issue at the time, and they were trying to find different ways to have data that could last a little bit longer on these credential cards. So due to the durability of Wiegand's wire, it's no surprise it was quickly adopted in the access control space. Wiegand's durability as a credential, like I was just mentioning, was superior to magstripe at the time. So Wiegand, the credential, is a series of those Wiegand wires I just discussed, sandwiched in between two pieces of plastic. And the Wiegand card has 26 wires in each card. 26, keep that in your head, because that will come into the next slide. There's 26 wires in each card. Each wire is placed in differing positions to represent the corresponding 0 and 1 bits used by the door controller. And modern proximity and smart cards are not Wiegand swipe cards, but their output is an emulation of the original Wiegand format. So these are the wires for the card, so whenever it goes through the swipe reader, each one of these is a 0 and a 1. These two on the end, actually I'll show you in the bitmap, are for parity, and then the inside of those wires is the facility code. So it's just literally all the byte information translated onto these wires based off of this position. So, like I brought up earlier, 26 wires, 26 bits. So the Wiegand format consists of 26 bits, bitmap to see here. To further complicate things, as I mentioned earlier, Wiegand is also a signaling protocol. So Wiegand readers that are expecting this data from this card, like on the back side of this little reader, the wire behind it, has two five-fold data lines, one for zeros, one for ones. So you can assume if all of the information is being translated through that wire in quote-unquote clear text, you could sniff it, theoretically. So Wiegand is a unidirectional protocol, leaving it vulnerable to relay and man-in-the-middle attacks. So let's move forward. RFID badges. So, who here besides Aaron can tell me the difference between high and low frequency RFID badges? Does anybody know?
Snarky.
Give me your answer.
What is high frequency? What is low?
Well, great. I want to just cue the area because basically, high-frequency cards are the more mature adaptation of the badging technology. Low-frequency was the original iteration. Low-frequency cards usually are between 26 to, like, I've seen up to, like, 42-bit configurations off of the Wiegand format. But, again, it's a low-frequency card. Again, I was bringing up how Wiegand is in clear text, that leaves it a more vulnerable type of card. So if you've ever done any research into badge cloning, or you just bought bought a flipper and now you're trying to flip the world, you've probably come across the terms high and low frequency somewhere in documentation. And essentially, this is the protocol for communication between the badge and the reader. That's the only time that this comes into play. So low frequency cards have less space on them than high frequency cards. So high frequency cards can encrypt their data and protect against cloning, unlike low frequency cards, which are a direct translation of the data that's on them, with no ability to encrypt it, so then you can just go clone cards all day long. So when it comes to the credentials and the difference between them, high frequency cards need to be unlocked with something called mutual authentication. So essentially the card will perform a secret handshake with the reader before it's able to exchange that information. So that again comes into the concept of encryption. It won't, like regular readers that read low frequency are constantly calling out asking for some kind of information to be read into the reader. And when those cards are constantly, like low frequency cards are just constantly yelling exactly everything, here's my PIN number, here's my social security number, buy all of it. High frequency cards won't tell you unless you have the secret handshake. So until the high frequency card touches the high frequency configured reader that's expecting that protocol, it will not encrypt that data, or it won't transfer the data, basically, between the two endpoints. So these are just a couple of the vendors. HID Procs, usually you hear about Procs cards. Wiegand, again, our friend right here. High frequency cards, iClass, SOES, MyFair, DesFire, and the newest iteration, which is DesFire EV3, came out in 2020, which those EV2 and EV3 are two of the most secure protocols that currently exist. So, like they always say, we're all the same on the inside. And the same is true for modern card credentials. So modern RFID card technology is just different ways to hold the same Wiegand format data we were discussing earlier. So when you present these different types of credentials to the reader, you're still technically converting it back to Wiegand. And converting it back to the Wiegand format that the industry agreed on back in the 90s. So over time, manufacturers develop more complicated Wiegand formats using encryption, intermixing the facility and code bits, and developing complex parity schemes. Their development was primarily to prevent other vendors from being able to issue cards on their readers. It was not for security. It was because they wanted to have a closed environment, and when you move to their product, you got to buy their readers. You got to buy their cards. Nobody wanted to share that information. Does that sound familiar to anybody? So, expectedly, manufacturers wouldn't have had that same pressing incentive to change the communication between the reader and the controller. And that's where our boy comes in. So thus, the most common protocol, even today, for communication between the badge reader and the controller panel is Wiegand. So there are a few other protocols out there that exist now. Again, all vendor specific. And the only one that is encrypted here is the one in red. So they came up with new versions, but still nobody cared about encryption. They just didn't want you to be able to use your readers with their stuff at the end of the day. So also, this final protocol, it is, so you see how there's OSDP V2 and then V2 with safe with secure comm protocol. When it was first issued, people pointed out that there were still vulnerabilities. They issued the encrypted version of it, but there's still, like, it's still not well known in the access control community how to properly implement that. So you can still do a lot of the prior exploits against some of the less secure encryption channels. So hang in there, everyone. You're doing great. I know that was a lot of information. And now that we got all the learning out of the way, it's time to start hacking. This is for you, but it's also for me. Exploit time. So what can you do at the end of the day? So some of the more common categories of attacks against physical access control systems are physical attacks, card cloning, downgrade attack, replay, and relay attacks. For fun, let's start with physical attacks. So physical attacks against access control are due mostly in part to human error and improper installation of hardware. patching these systems is difficult and usually requires replacement of components and or moving of sensors. To truly patch configuration issues with these systems, it's going to require collaboration between the maintenance teams of a facility and the access control employees, which usually the maintenance people and the access control people are two totally different vendors, and most of the time they also don't work for the building you're in. So imagine trying to coordinate all of that together into fixing these vulnerabilities. So the under the door tool is this little guy right here. You slip it in a gap underneath a door. This piece is usually what's in your hand. This piece connects to the door, and then there's a little circle right here that you grab with your finger so that you can whip it around the door handle, pull it, and let yourself in from the other side. The only real fix for that is to put something right here, like a little piece of metal to kind of obstruct that, just make it more difficult so that hopefully one of your employees sees this flopping around in the door before somebody comes in, because that's what you want your employees, as part of the last layer of defense against your systems, to keep things like that look sketchy like that in mind. So you have the double door tool, which you can slap in between a gate right here and open this mechanism, which is called a crash bar. Those crash bars are for, oh no, the building's on fire. The last thing you want is for people to be messing with the door. Pull, push, everybody's on fire. So you have a crash bar for so those crisis situations, people can exit the building safely. And at the same time, you just need a little piece of metal in there, push the crash bar, now you're in. A can of compressed air, which a lot of people have seen, like Devin Tolman has done it, where you stick a can of air with a little straw in between the gap and the door to trigger the request to exit sensor, which is usually the little sensor that's on doors when you walk up that unlocks it when it sees somebody step in front of it. Again, to patch that, you gotta move the sensor. So now you gotta get the sensor moved, you gotta call the network guy, it's a big undertaking to patch those systems, but to any tester's advantage, those are things to keep in mind. If you own the building, that's maybe something you want to call your vendor about when you leave here. And then lock picking. I'm not even going to go into that because you can check out the Lockpick Village to see more. But I will say, if you see someone at your office building picking a lock and they aren't necessarily a lock picker and they're just a normal looking person, maybe you might want to tell somebody. Just saying. It's one of the louder versions of physical attacks. So now we're going to go into card cloning. So given a brief period of access to a card, you want to create an object that can stand in for the card at time of authentication, which is only possible with low-frequency cards or high-frequency cards whose encryption has been broken. It's one of the more popular exploits. Usually the first thing everybody tries to do as soon as they get their flipper is clone their work patch. So a lot of people who that has failed for, you possibly had one of the more secure protocols. Good for your job, not fun for you. So either way, as you start to learn more about this, you can start to find more low frequency cards and readers, and then you can start making your own little clones and having fun. Low frequency cards can be read at a greater distance than high frequency cards, also increasing its risk for being captured by a malicious party. So just going back to this diagram from earlier, all of these in red are clonable. They've had their encryption broken. These other versions still have not had their encryption broken as of me talking about this talk today. With quantum computing, who knows maybe when that will happen, but as of today, these are the cards that you can currently clone. These cards at the top, the 125 frequency, can be cloned with your flipper if you get the right firmware with the right, because when you go through the menus, you'll see the different types, and you just need to find the right type for what type of reader and card you're using. Because each, like I brought up before, each one of these protocols is vendor specific, just for the reason of they don't want you to be able to use it with other things. So you can read that frequency, but you may need to make sure you have the right drivers at the end of the day. So, downgrade attack. So, this will read the UID from a credential using an attacker-controlled legitimate reader and write it onto a credential using a less secure technology, possible due to misconfigurations during deployment to remove acceptance of older protocols. Functionality exists to help with migrations. This exists to help with migrations for when you are moving to a more secure protocol. So let's say you had a test. Now we're working on remediating different points from that test. And you found out that all of your readers are procs, and anybody can clone it, and maybe you cloned a badge, and now you're trying to talk about remediation. The access control vendor will start to work on a migration, and they will reconfigure your readers to accept multiple protocols at that point. But the one thing they probably aren't going to do is come back and remove the old protocol, which is what leaves this up for the downgrade attacks. Forgot to close port 3389. Now you're in. So certain tools allow for downgrade attacks with very minimal effort. For example, Proxmark, there's an iCopyX. Flipper Zero can do this attack if you use this extra expansion board that's on top. I will tell you where to get it on the last slide. But it's building up. Replay attack. So given the full sequence of messages exchanged between a card and a reader during one or more successful authentications, create some sort of object that can stand in for the card at time of authentication. Sorry, I forgot to put that last sentence. Only possible if the UID of the card is known or the encryption is broken. And the difference between relay and replay attack is that in a replay attack, the credential can be saved. So with the replay attack, that's also, it's very similar to a relay attack, but with a relay attack, you only get to move the packet of information over one time. Like, once you have it captured, you're not able to save it and then rewrite it, which is where, like, rolling codes come in, like the codes for your cards and things like that. Like the codes for your car fobs, I mean. And replay attacks are coming to be actually a lot more prevalent in the mainstream space nowadays because of car theft, and replay and relay is finally starting to get a lot more attention as from vendors, car vendors, different types of things, because hey, this is something only a bunch of nerds knew about, but now you can buy a lot of these tools very easily online, Alibaba, eBay, and it's becoming to where anybody can kind of learn this kind of stuff, and vendors are starting, now that it's starting to get bad and they're getting in trouble, they're starting to come back from that. And my personal favorite, relay attacks. So you authenticate to a reader with a card located some distance away and only assume brief access to the card and the reader. Can only be used, again, against credentials that have not, This one is different from all of the other ones in that it can be used against credentials that have not had their encryption broken yet. So with the replay attack, because you can use it against broken encryption, that's why you can save it, because you know the encryption schema that the device is expecting. With relay attack, you're just kind of holding the credential in a suspended state to then bring it to the door that you want to open. And it's not possible on the two most secure protocols I brought up earlier, only because they actually started doing something about relay attacks, and they put a basically in the reader itself, it will only, like, it's hardwired programmed to only accept it for 15 seconds. So if you were going to try to do a relay attack, it would drop the request before you would ever be able to complete it, because they knew this was existing and people were exploiting it for years. Vendors also aren't really looking at patching older versions, because they'll either suggest to their end user, hey, we need a second factor. So if you have a really secure space, like your server room, data center, what have you, usually you'll have, or like in banking, sometimes they'll put the really high level rich bankers in a secret room with a card door. And sometimes give you pins, biometrics, what have you, but they want you to put a second factor so then you don't have to replace the door reader. You have that second thing, so then the relay attack risk goes away, because you can't open the door if you don't have the second factor. But I bring all of that up because if you see right here by this beautiful pie chart and this black piece right here, in today's environment, there's a very tiny amount of cards that are currently not vulnerable to this. The rest of them are. So it's showing you that people aren't necessarily in the biggest rush to get this fixed. And Shout out to Loud & Mouth Security, which actually inspired this talk because they did a talk at DEF CON 31 this year called Unlocking Doors from Half-Con in a Way. And they were using the Proxmarks and the an extra expansion board that they actually personally developed that will talk with your phone. So they were able to open a door on stage in Las Vegas to Ottawa, Canada, because the credential was being sent over mobile network from the Prox device to the door that they wanted to open all the way in Las Vegas. So I would definitely check that out if you want to learn more about a really cool relay attack. And like I brought up earlier, the issue, this is basically a diagram of how those people are coming nowadays. They're reporting on it in the news how thieves are going to your house and walking near your front porch to try to capture the signal given off by your key fob when you throw your key fob by the door. So then they can come and take your nice brand new car you worked really hard to earn and drive away with it. And because, like I brought up earlier, it's a rolling code, they wouldn't be able to clone it and then use it more than once. They need to grab it, capture it, and throw it into your car, and then drive away. So, very scary. Make sure you have good car insurance. So, popular RFID research tools. We have the Proxmark, which this was the most comprehensive tool you can currently buy for this type of research. You do usually need an external thing to plug it into, a phone, a computer, which then increases its size for, you know, if you're trying to be a little bit more covert, that's something to bring into your mind. But the flipper itself can work in standby mode, but usually you need it plugged into another device to do some of the more complicated type of attacks. The Flipper Zero, which people have seen a lot of recently, is kind of like a Swiss Army knife of a lot of these features. But as time's going on, more and more people are starting to release more firmware for the Flipper. So in the Prox community, there is infamous firmware developer called Iceman. And Iceman has his own firmware. He's actually right here on Iceman Collection. And he has his own firmware that usually has all of the cutting edge experimental type of exploits against RFID systems. So when those gentlemen I was talking about on the prior slide released their firmware, Iceman had it ported over the next day. And it was on his firmware for release on GitHub. He also, so I imagine him and maybe other people in the industry will start transferring over some of this compatibility to the Flipper Zero. And that other thing I brought up earlier, this little guy on top of the Flipper Zero, is actually an expansion card that, because I brought up earlier how you can only do 125 with just this little guy, for you to do some of the more secure protocols, you need that secondary added on board. But hey, now you can do more stuff. And then, just for honorable mention, I also have the iCopy X, which I will be honest with you guys, Proxmark learning is quite a bit of a learning curve. To say it's user-friendly would be an understatement. It takes a lot of trial and error, a lot of digging through forms, a lot of doing things wrong a bunch, and that became kind of a big issue for people when they were trying to focus on physical penetration testing. That's where the iCopy X comes in. It's a Proxmark with a nice interface on it and a screen. So then you can do basically all of these attacks from this larger face device. It's a little bit larger than a cell phone, kind of like this older cell phone. But the iCopy X is basically a Proxmark with a nice case on it, so then you don't need the extra computer. You can do a lot of those things in the field, and you kind of don't need to add on all those extra add-ons. So, now where can you buy this stuff? Personally, I have bought from Hacker Warehouse and Red Team Tools. That expansion board for the Flipper Zero is on Red Team Tools. The co-owner of Red Team Tools is actually one of the co-founders of the Lockpick Village in DEF CON. Good guy, really in the community. Hacker Warehouse is really in the community, so I would always suggest going. I usually go to Hacker Warehouse first. Red Team Tools has a lot of more specialized stuff, but you kind of, you know, this community gets built by people like us, people giving back to the community, presenting their research. This is my first talk at any of these conferences. So sharing collaborating and giving back to the community is how we get cool stuff like this. It's how we get cool little toys that you can buy and then start turning off TVs and opening Tesla charger ports. Like, you, if you just don't think that your information is not good enough, share it. Share it with anyone. I was expecting one of you to raise your hand today and tell me the difference between 125 and, like, between high and low frequency. And I'm glad now you've walked away with a new piece of information. I know. I already knew that. But dangerous things, and then Sparrow's lockpicks, honorable mention as well. Dangerous things sounds a little bit more limited than Hacker Warehouse. Sparrow lockpicks, all lockpicks, everything, anything you want lockpick-wise, the double door tool, under the door tool, everything is there. So I would definitely go there. But thank you.